Good morning. Thank you, Susan, for the introduction, and thank you to AFSA for organizing this tribute to our hostages and all of those who were part of their ordeal. Just as most Americans can tell you where they were when President Kennedy was shot or when the Twin Towers came down on 9/11, I think every diplomat of a certain age recalls what they were doing when our colleagues were taken hostage in Tehran. The initial pictures of our people being led from the chancery in blindfolds were seared in our memories. And though we did not know at the time how long or how painful the hostages' ordeal would be, we instantly recognized that our world and our profession would be forever changed. That perception was borne out just weeks later when rioters burned our embassy in Pakistan and our colleagues throughout NEA were evacuated. Many see our world in the wake of 9/11 attacks as profoundly less safe. I think the diplomats in 1979 also felt the same way. But there were important lessons from this experience. Yes, the world can be a frightening and unfriendly place, and the threats we faced then and now are very real. But we also learned that Americans, and particular State Department employees, are resilient. At the time, I think everyone in the State Department and in the Foreign Service knew or knew someone who knew each one of the hostages in Iran. For me, it was an OMS from my first tour in Ottawa who had saved me in the econ section. If Elizabeth Montaigne is here this morning, a very warm welcome to her. We also learned, as the situation evolved, that these people were not going to let this experience define them. They moved on with their lives, they remained extremely good colleagues, and they went on to do most impressive work. I personally can salute Ambassador Victor Tomseth and Michael Howland, with whom I worked later on, in their dignity, their professionalism, their perseverance, along with all of those who were held hostage. They have exemplified what makes our diplomatic corps great. May none of us ever have to endure what they did, and may we all draw strength from their faith and their courage in facing and indeed overcoming the challenges and the dangers of our very, very unpredictable world. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador Powell. Before we begin, I'd like to recognize some special guests present here today and also to take this opportunity to convey the sincere regrets and warm regards of Undersecretary Bill Burns to the hostages. He was not able to attend at the last minute due to a conflict at the NSC. Now, I would like to recognize some special guests here, Kevin O'Shea from the Canadian Embassy, former hostages, former hostages Stephen Lauterbach and Stephen Kirtley, who are in attendance here today, as well as Robert Anders. Robert was one of the diplomats who were saved by our Canadian colleagues. I would now like to invite our panel participants to take seats, their seats on the stage. These five diplomats and all of their colleagues were awarded the department's award for valor for their courage and sacrifice. And I'll now introduce them one by one. Ambassador Bruce Langen. Thank you. Ambassador John Limbert. Mr. Alan Golosinski. Mr. Donald Cook. and Mr. Barry Rosen. And finally, NBC's Chief Foreign Affairs Correspondent, Andrea Mitchell, who will moderate the program. And we're very grateful to Andrea. So thank you all for joining us today, and I'm now going to turn the program over to Andrea.
Thank you so very much. I can't tell you what a privilege it is for me to be here with many friends and colleagues, and to be here really to honor service, to honor our diplomats, our Foreign Service officers, their families. This experience 30 years ago was my first experience as a new correspondent at NBC News. And so I feel that I know all of you. I've met many of you since, but I feel that I learned so much about you while you were suffering in captivity, and it is a thrill, really, to be here and to use this as a moment to honor our ongoing, the service of our diplomats, especially on a day when we are hearing dreadful reports out of Cairo. It is simply another reminder that you are all on the front lines, serving quietly and effectively in posts around the world, unheralded, often underappreciated, many of us feel. And to honor all of you by recalling the horrible events, the joy of 30 years ago, but the events that preceded it. I'd like to start with Bruce Langen, our most senior diplomat, the man who was really in charge on that day, and ask you to recall what happened and bring us back to the beginning of the taking over of the hostage, which forever changed our relations up until this very day with the government in Tehran.
Thank you, Andrea.
Can you hear me?
They can, indeed.
One person was not mentioned, I don't think, in the introductions, and that's that young Marine sitting over there on the far left.
They got him. They got him.
They got him. Major Kirtley. But is he the only Marine who's here today? I mean, Marines never retire, but I mention him particularly because the security guards of the United States Marine Corps or the American Foreign Service are special. And he was special then. This were all of my Marine colleagues at that time. And I want you to give a round of applause to the Marine Corps of the United States for the security guards that they give us.
Major Kirtley, do you want to stand?
I think my colleagues will remember him. He was a young squirt, about 19 years of age or something. And now he's a retired major in the Marine Corps, and we are very proud of him. All of us are. You asked me to say something about what happened that
well,
night?
That's
well, something happened and got us into trouble.
Yeah, just if you can recount from your experience, you know, just the emotions and the events. And I know that you were held separately, but we
yeah,
can then
wasn't
go
supposed
on to John Embert and the others.
It wasn't supposed to happen that way. But I had a long-standing commitment to the foreign ministry of Iran in the Islamic. It wasn't an Islamic Republic yet at that point, the Republic of Iran, to go to the foreign ministry and talk in a meeting arranged very carefully for several days beforehand with representatives of the Iranian foreign ministry to talk about, of all things, the future diplomatic immunity status of my military liaison office. That was our agenda that morning, and that's what we had that morning. We completed the agenda, and then in the process of completing it, we got into trouble. Some word came to us via Ellen Golasinski, one of our security officers, and Mike Howland, that things were happening over on the other side of town, that the foreign ministry was being overrun. No, it wasn't overrun. The American embassy was being overrun. that posed a problem. We had to either had to do something. And my first instinct was to seek the foreign minister of Iran at that point, only to find him in all, of all places, in Algiers that morning on his way home from the 25th anniversary celebration of the Islamic, of the Algiers regime. He got there eventually. I spent the balance of the day myself, together with my two associates at that time, my deputy, the foreign number two of the embassy at that time, Victor Thomseth, who isn't here this morning, but was with us the other day up in Wiesbaden,
at West Point.
At West Point. He and Victor Thomseth and Ellen at the other side of town were trying to make sure that we got the help we deserved under all traditions and of Islamic, of diplomatic history. The regime was obligated to provide us the assistance we needed to protect us. That's their job. Only to find that they were helpless at that point themselves. But we spent the rest of the day, I did, together with Victor Thomson and Mike Howland, the other security officer, trying to find the help we were obligated, should have had from the income, from the regime, under all precepts and rules of international law. Of course, they didn't do it, couldn't do it. By the end of the day, they were out of power. And by the next morning, we were all hostages together with my colleagues over at the other side of town. I was caught in the foreign ministry with my two colleagues, and that's where we spent the balance of our time, except for the last several weeks when we were in solitary confinement. But all my colleagues who were here, they were on the other side of town, beginning their 444 days of solitary confinement, etc., for the rest of the time.
Now, Al Kolesinski, you were the predecessor of what we now know of as diplomatic security on the front lines, along with the Marine Guards. Tell us about the actual event. And I know that there were several times where things got very, very rough indeed. Twice there were, I believe, mock executions. So I wanted to ask you and Barry and John about that.
Sure. If I may just back up for a moment on what Bruce was talking about, and the reason I'm doing this is it's 30 years hence, and people today can't imagine what happened to us happening, and how could that have happened? I mean, after all, there was the Alamo in the United States. How could this possibly happen, that this magnificent embassy goes down like this to what at that time was termed as a bunch of students? And it went beyond that. And I won't belabor the point. Suffice it to say that that's the way we did things at that time, whether it was in Tehran, whether it was in Beirut, whether it was in other places. We were very, very, very dependent on the terms of the Vienna Convention. And as Bruce mentioned, he tried valiantly and desperately to have help come to our rescue, as it did earlier that year. Some of you may recall or have heard that the embassy was overrun earlier that year. So basically, to not go into the gory details of it, but to say that what we were trying to do is we were trying to buy time with the expectation that the cavalry would arrive, as they did on February 14th, we would get to leave, probably not get to take our Persian rugs with us and other things that we had accumulated, but our assignments would have been curtailed and off we would go to some other adventure. Unfortunately, and as we all know, it didn't turn out that way. I would be remiss in not calling attention, as Bruce did, to the Marines. Their performance that day was unbelievable, absolutely unbelievable. What they did, perhaps another way of saying it, is what they didn't do, went against every bit of training they had received. But it was
Al, how many Marines were there up against the mob?
Well, we only had 9 at that point. We had a total detachment of 14. And I should say we had 14, a total detachment of 14. As you said that, I can picture running down the stairs and one of the Marines holding about 60 people at bay with a riot shotgun, what's called an 870P, if for those of you that want to be technical. And the fact that he did not shoot, it was just unbelievable. And I just saw him, we were at West Point the other day, and to this day I remain so incredibly proud of him, because it would have been easier for him to shoot.
Let me just, you know, follow up on
Barry Rosen. Why don't you move the mic over, Barry?
In 1998, I was in Paris. I met with Abbas Abdi, who was one of the strategists of the takeover of the embassy. And I think that was an attempt by possibly the Khatami regime to start some sort of ping-pong diplomacy. But Abbas Abdi actually told me that the initial strategy was that they wanted the Marines to shoot and kill one of the student.
Which would have given them the predicate.
Yes, it would have given them the opportunity, the predicate, to kill us, he said, to actually kill us. And there's no doubt about it. But there's one other point that I think is very ironic, and I think Bruce and all of us know that. For many months, we were held almost prisoner by a committee of sorts run by a butcher who had his own control over the embassy, entrance in and entrance out. And I presume that if he was still there and if we didn't negotiate him out with the provisional government, that he might have stopped the students from coming over the wall. And I, you know, for me, that was the, you know, the great irony of that whole situation.
Well, I think not, Barry. But because it was my job when I was sent out there to get rid of him, as Bruce well knows. But just
for the record, that guy was a thug.
Yes, he was.
He was a thug.
Yes, he was our thug.
He was out.
But if I may make this final point on this, because it's very important. What we faced that day, and my colleagues who were there, I'm sure, will share this sentiment, was not the worst thing that we had faced. We had very recently been subjected to a rocket and grenade attack. As Barry mentioned, we had our own resident thug. They took great sport in firing at the Marines as they came to work, and our Marines thought, you know, okay, this is part of our training. But we can make light of it now. But it was a very, very difficult situation. Thankfully, I think the Foreign Service has matured, and I would hope, and I understand, that we probably would not put our people in that kind of jeopardy. Not to say they're not in jeopardy, but I think we would not leave them out there as we were. Anyway,
but
thank you very much for the opportunity.
Just to put in the current context, though, I'm not sure how much any of us really focused on Tunisia until it happened, nor Cairo, and we have compliments of diplomats at posts throughout Egypt and throughout the region and in other places in Yemen where they are facing the same, potentially the same kind of jeopardy. Presumably, well, we all know that in the intervening decades, security provisions have changed dramatically, and we know after 1998 that in fact our embassies are now set back and guarded to the extent that it does interfere with a lot of what many of you had always experienced as healthy and important interactions with the publics of the countries in which you're posted. John Limbert, let's talk about some of the worst times. There were moments, the mock executions that you and I have discussed before.
Well, you know, it's the memories of that time, for me, speaking about, someone mentioned maturing, the memories of those times for me are very vivid. What I had problem with this morning was finding my car keys. Some of you may be able to identify with that. No, we're not, as a service, things we can talk about, things have changed and they have, and we do a lot of things much better now than we did. But the one thing we still have great difficulty doing is thinking the unthinkable. I mean, if I or someone, one of us up here, had predicted the course of the Iranian Revolution accurately, or if we had said we're going to be taken over and held for 14 months, we would have been medevaced on psychological grounds, probably justifiably so. this thing started out, I think we looked, many of us looked at it as, and again, some, maybe I'm dating myself, but as a 1970s-style sit-in. I mean, some of us remember those days. We marched into the university president's office. We drank his scotch. We rifled his files. We smoked his cigars. We issued some brave communique, and we marched out.
How'd you get your clearance?
Fred,
for those of you who didn't hear, Al just asked, how did he get his clearance? Just want to put that on
friends
the
in friends in high places. and that's what... that's what it appeared we were dealing with. And when I caught one of the things we did, I mean, I know that Bruce and others at the Foreign Ministry were working very hard to get some to get those people to do their responsibilities. And I called, I think I from the embassy, we called everywhere we knew. I called the Foreign Ministry as well. I got a secretary on the line, and just as identified myself as the American Embassy, here's what she said. She said, oh, the American Embassy, wonderful to hear from you. You know those passports we sent over for visas? Are they ready yet? And all I could say was, lady, if you don't do something about this, you'll never see those visas. You know, if she's in the room, I apologize. I don't know if she's here, but it started. This is the way it started off. And according to, I don't know if this is true, but according to Abbas Abdi and some of the others, that's the way they looked at it.
Yes.
Also, they were going to march in, do this brave thing, make a statement, march and march out. It turned into, of course, this huge international event. And crisis, which brought down an American president, among other things, but so all we could say was this thing can't go on. Somebody, some adult, is going to get in the middle of it. We'll fix it and we'll set things right. But I personally, my wake up moment came about 2 months into this when I got a care package from home. And my family had sent me, and they sent me some things, including some books to read. And the books were things like War and Peace, Brothers Karamazov, Middlemarch, you know, average length about 1,300 pages. And I said to myself, somebody's trying to tell me something. They're trying to get me, they're trying to say, you know, read these books because you're going to be there for a while.
I wanted
that's
to
exactly
bring
what you wanted at that time.
Yeah.
Things that used up time, and 1,300 pages takes a long time under those circumstances.
You know, but I would add that we're not adding one important thing, and that is the admission of the Shah into the United States, and I think that occurred on October 22nd, and the debate within the embassy. And Bruce, I remember you leading it and the discussions that we had about it all.
About the advisability of
the advisability
of
it all. And then we said that we really feel that this is the wrong decision to make. And if you're going to make this decision, get us out of here.
And was Washington advised of that?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely, 100%. And also, President Carter even mentioned it in one of his books when he asked members of the Security Council, what will happen if they're taken hostage? No one answered. There was no reason for us to be there anymore. I was in the February 14th event when we were taken over for one day, and we were almost murdered by the Fedayeen Echal. Immediately, we were taken out, and the discussion was whether we should go back again. And I honestly feel the decision should have been made in Washington to get us out as soon as the Shah got in. And I think, would have been something to show the Iranians that, okay, when you're ready, you can call us back in or ask us to come back in. But right now, we're not going to do it. And that was never, never disputed by the State Department.
Don Cook, you were 26 years old.
25. This is a infamous lie that I'm that old.
Glad you correct the record. Tell me about
as a young officer at the time, the experience and what happened when you came out, because we are celebrating the release 30 years ago, and I can only imagine you're landing at Stewart Air Force Base and on your way to West Point and having no idea of how important you were to Americans for the entire 14-month period.
This is an important point. On the very first day, one of the things you start talking about when you're in an experience like this is, when are you going home? And you start speculating on what the possibilities are, and maybe you create some artificial deadlines. Well, surely they'll have us home by Christmas, et cetera. People who are familiar with the Korean War heard that a number of years in a row. And on the first day, someone asked me, you know, realistically, how long could this last? And my response to that person, even as the demonstrators were outside, was to remember the Pueblo. The Pueblo was an American patrol boat, listening vessel off the coast of Korea, which was also captured during an election year. And the election year cycle just freezes the ability of people to do things. And the people on the Pueblo were released after the election, but before the inauguration. And I was telling the person that we're in an election year, and so this is the potential. To go beyond that, the Iranians were being advised by, I believe, Palestinians, and they got very freaked out when I suggested that this possibility existed. And their advisors had told them that you don't want to tell the captives any of the circumstances, the international news or national news, related to their position, because you don't want them to know what's going on and perhaps act in a way that you don't want them to. And so they kept all information away from us about what was going on, except they would tell us occasionally that, you know, this is a big thing in the United States, and on the news every night, the commentator, the newscasters start out with, this is day 132 of the hostage crisis in Iran, and we frankly didn't believe them. You know, once again, I mean, the reaction was, remember the Pueblo. There was some news when they were first taken. There was some news when some propaganda photographs came out. And there was some news when they were released. But there was certainly not a national uprising or a national focus on getting the people on the Pueblo freed. And so that was a very big difference and a real surprise, and clearly, obviously, a very pleasant surprise for us to know that really everybody in the United States really cared. And I'd like to go back. It is a different time. It is 30 years later. And something that John Limbert was reminding us of, I think that the historians have missed the real significance of the hostage crisis. And that is that it really represented the end of the Vietnam War period. For a long period of time, it was easy to be embarrassed to be an American. It was easy to accept the criticism that the U.S. and the Soviet Union were really the same, and these sorts of things. And this was finally such an outrageous act against the United States. We really were in Iran to try to help the new government. We had really helped facilitate the change in power there. We had not gone in and tried to prop up this dictator. And yet, even in response to that, our embassy was taken. And this was a chance for Americans to say, no, you know, we really are something different. We really are not what our enemies declare that we are. And I think that's the real significance of the hostage taking and our release, is that it really brought about a change in American attitudes about ourselves. And it's something that I'm really very proud of. And also, it affected the way we treat the current conflicts that we're in. We may not agree about what's going on in Iraq or Afghanistan. People can certainly disagree about the policy, but there's absolutely total unanimous agreement that we're going to support our troops there, and that we're going to support the men and women of the Foreign Service and the other civilian agencies that are working in both countries. Very, very different from the Vietnam War.
Andre, I just wanted to add one thing. I think that we forgot to say, pay tribute to our spouses and families who worked tirelessly, the family liaison action group, and all of our families who worked with and sometimes against the State Department. And maybe the State Department worked against some of the things that our spouses wanted too. And I really want to pay tribute to Penny and, you know, and all the rest of the members too. And Parvaneh.
Why don't you stand? We should say that we're all wearing yellow ribbons, and it's iconic. It is a part of American culture now. But as Bruce reminded me last week when we had a conversation on my program, that before this experience, there were no yellow ribbons. Mm-hmm. There were no ribbons. Ribbons have now become a mark. We just saw it at the State of the Union, the black and white ribbons paying tribute to the heroism and to the victims in Tucson. Of course, the pink ribbons for AIDS, the red ribbons for AIDS, and the pink ribbons for breast cancer. But it was really, Bruce, the oak tree in your front yard, Penny. And the start, and Penny, and the beginning of the yellow ribbons, which was more than just a symbol. It really became a rallying cry around America in your absence.
And it's still not today. We never fail to mention breast cancer, pink ribbons, and the ribbons you just mentioned relating to the tragedy out in Arizona. I wanted to mention in this context we're supposed to be heroes. Mm-hmm. That's the way we were seen. But all of us sitting here would always say the real heroes are our families back home. They were the ones that worked the hardest against unknown circumstances. They were frustrated. They didn't know what they were supposed to do. Their State Department wasn't as cooperative as they'd like to be. But they went on and did it, and I resalute all of those who did that. I wanted to add one thing when I've got the floor. You all have this, I think, or many of you do, that list a lot of names, including those who were released earlier. And I suspect there are some in the audience who were released within 3 weeks. Those were horrendous 3 weeks. They worried all the time and were abused all of the time. Any of that group in the audience today, if there is, please raise your hands. Lillian Johnson isn't here? No. She's one of our real heroes, as you all would know over here. But I salute them for what they tried to do at that time and gave so much of their time and life in those 13 days. The other person and people I want to salute is that lady sitting over there in a yellow suit or whatever that is. Well, it's a jacket, I guess. That's the real hero of this crisis, of that crisis, because they're the ones who came forward in Wiesbaden as psychiatrists. And that lady over there is my favorite psychiatrist. Why don't you stand up?
I want to particularly salute Dr. Esther Roberts because she became a very close and dear friend of my parents and really helped support them while they were in circumstances, as Bruce points out, more grave than us. I mean, we had a pretty good idea what was going on, but the families back at home, they were being really torn apart by, you know, are they going to be released, are they going to be shot, et cetera. And Dr. Roberts and the other part of the State Department medical team really worked hard to keep the families, to support
the families.
So
you transitioned through Wiesbaden, as Americans do from points of conflict, and you came back. The United States had just gone through this transition, a political transition. You were released moments after the swearing-in ceremony. And we had our perspective, but from your perspective, John, maybe ask you, what was the experience of landing and seeing the reception for you?
Well, again, most of us, I think, were clueless about what had happened back here. Don, you mentioned that. and how this incident had changed things in the States, and where it stood in the news cycle. So I can say from my own experience, landing in Wiesbaden in Frankfurt at 6 in the morning in January, dark, cold, snowy, and we pull up to the terminal, and there are hundreds of people outside waiting for something and shouting and holding signs. And I turned to somebody and I said, "My gosh, what's going on? Somebody important is landing here, I guess." And then it just sort of snowballed from there. And then getting back to West Point, and at least personally, I think I was in a bit of a fog. And as we're riding those buses, and all the people were there, thousands of people were there, my wife kept saying, "Wave to them, wave to them." They're expecting it. They're expecting it. So I think we had no idea. But the good thing, and this is, I think, one of the strong points of the Foreign Service in general. You always come back to land. You always come back to reality. Okay, we were at the White House. We were on CNN, which had just started. I'm sorry to mention a rival network.
The fact is that we were just discussing before we came out here, this was transformative also in media terms. This was the beginning of Nightline with Ted Koppel on ABC, the beginning of cable news. And I was describing to my colleagues here that when I first started as an NBC correspondent, as the junior person back then, my job, because we didn't have 24/7 cable news, was to spend the nights on a couch in the newsroom in case you all got released. So in particular...
Well, you spent a lot of time in that couch.
We spent a lot of time. Okay. So I was living, sort of a remote, living a strange kind of existence, a comfortable existence, I should add. But on holidays in particular, you mentioned the possibility of getting released on Christmas, Don. I was assigned to be at the State Department for every major holiday overnight, and we just would stay in the little cubicles. Diane Sawyer was my counterpart, another new correspondent at CBS in those days. And we just stayed up all night, chatting and sharing stories on Christmas night and Christmas Eve, just in case something were to happen. So there was no 24/7, pre-internet, and it's hard to explain to people what it was like then.
But all of this, I mean, as I said, the good thing is all of this 15 minutes of fame is over. It was over, and having been to the White House, having been here and there, within a week or so, you're standing out in the cold in Washington waiting for a bus. But I really knew I was home when I encountered the personnel system of the State Department. And Nancy, I think it was one of your predecessors, and I will not mention a name, who said something like, I wanted to ask about onward assignments, and he said, "Well, they really released you at a very bad time in the assignment cycle."
That reminds me of one of the countless signs we saw along the road from Andrews that day coming into Washington. Many of the signs told us things we didn't really appreciate, particularly one that said, "The IRS welcomes you home."
Andrew, to actually emphasize how isolated we were, and really this whole thing came to us as an amazing situation. For example, there was an anecdote that I like to talk about. Dave Rader and I, Lieutenant Colonel, spent 2 months in one place outside of Isfahan that we called the Black Hole. And what the Iranians gave us, basically, to read was the Washington Post classified boat section.
That was very useful.
Yes. But Dave, since he's a wonderful boater, he actually put us on the Chesapeake every afternoon. I'd lie down, and we would take trips on the Chesapeake day in and day out.
In your mind?
In our mind, basically, yes. But that's why we really didn't know anything. And, in fact, the whole issue of the attempted rescue, which was a horrible situation, we didn't learn it until 3 months after. I was in a bathroom that we used that they had a camera there, and I was able to abscond with a newspaper. And then in the newspaper, I brought it back into the cell, and there I read about the attempted rescue. And that was 3 months later.
Now, let me ask you, there are 1,100, approximately 1,100 Foreign Service officers now in unaccompanied posts, obviously places that are considered too dangerous to have families. Al, are they better protected now? And, you know, that's one part of the question. They obviously are better protected, but are they well enough protected? And to all of you, how does that interfere with your ability to perform the role of being a diplomat?
Well, let me say, I would be reluctant to say or to give it a grade, but I would feel very safe in saying that they are better protected today than they would have been 30 years ago. I mean, our eyes have been opened. I'm reminded of the very delicate balance that exists between conducting our mission, the Foreign Service's mission, the Department's mission, and for those within the Department that are charged with providing the security so that that mission can be accomplished. And all of you know, we're often butting heads on the issue, but everybody is trying to accomplish the same mission. You're making a wonderful point. I mean, what we went through 30 years ago seemed so unique, and today the potential exists just about everybody, everywhere in the world. So for those Foreign Service officers that are out there on the front lines, we wish you well. I mean, it's not safe.
In a slightly better position to answer this, I came back last February from a one-year assignment in Iraq where I led the provincial reconstruction team in Karbala province.
And that's the exact point, because those teams are taking over as we transition under the Status of Forces Agreement. It is going to be a largely civilian venture, supposedly, and that's, of course, the end game in Afghanistan as well down the road.
When I was in Tehran, there was very little tracking of what a frankly irresponsible junior officer was doing, and I would head out at nights with Iranian friends, and they just told me, sit in the back, and if someone asks you where you're from, answer in Farsi, Manzandaran, because you have a kind of a Manzandarani accent. And I went up to the Caspian coast with a group of people, but in Karbala province in Iraq, in our missions in Iraq, a Foreign Service officer doesn't get out the door without three armored vehicles and eight bodyguards. So in my case, it was four up-armored Humvees and eight Army soldiers. So it has changed. It does make things a little bit more difficult. I mean, it does have an effect on how you're perceived when you come with this very heavy armed presence. But I think in balance, it's probably better that we protect our people the way we do now than leave it the way we had in the past, where people were pretty much on their own and allowed to do, frankly, irresponsible things.
Now, I wanted to leave some time for questions. I'm not sure where the microphones are or whether we can all be heard, but let's see. Yes, right here.
Christian Carl, Radio Free Europe, Radio Liberty. Now, we know that this experience was very traumatic for you personally and your families. We know, as one of you mentioned, that it had a huge effect on American domestic politics. One could perhaps also argue that it was ended up being a very bad deal for the Iranian people as well. And I wonder if any of you could comment on that, on its effect on domestic Iranian politics and how you see that.
Good question. The question, sorry if it's off mic, I see now that there are microphones at the foot of both of those steps if people want to go there for asking questions. But the question was about the effect on the Iranian people, given what has happened in the decades since, that it has certainly not
that takeover and the rupture of relations. Barry, do you want to?
Well, I think that one important factor is that by the takeover of the U.S. Embassy, Ayatollah Khomeini and those who were leading the Islamic Republic eventually saw that they were able to destroy not only any relationship with the United States, but also the politically aware groups within Iran, and so that they would have no opposition. In point of fact, all the cable traffic that we had with people and who were meeting us were eventually caught up in this whole thing, so that the opposition to the regime already was destroyed, and it emboldened the Islamic Republic and made it stronger.
Please. And let me also ask you, just to follow up on what you anticipate in Cairo, given what we know about the Mubarak regime.
Oh, God.
What we know today, many of you may have been briefed more recently than I, is that there has been a major crackdown, cutting off of internet access and social media, and we don't know about arrests and other after effects.
I'm glad you asked that question. Radio Free, of course, you have Radio Farda. It started off as Radio Azadi, the Persian service. I have made that on any interview, whether it's VOA Persian, BBC Persian, Radio Farda, whatever, I make exactly that point. I said, and many Iranians have often, for example, called into those programs and said, well, we apologize for what happened to you. We think it was terrible. And my point has always been that he said, what happened to us was difficult. It was frightening. It was very uncomfortable. But what happened to the real victims of this thing were the Iranians, who have suffered for 30 years and continue to suffer under a very difficult and very harsh regime, which took power thanks to those events. The irony of this is that some of the individuals, including the one that Barry met and others, kind of late in the day woke up to what they had done was wrong, was a mistake, and became latter-day reformists and advocates of the rule of law, which always struck me as very ironic given what they had done. And once in a while, they have landed in prison.
Yes.
And I must say, I shouldn't feel this way, but when they do land in prison, I get a certain satisfaction out of it. The thing about Cairo, you asked about Cairo, and again, there are people here in this room who have to work these things, very difficult issues. I'm sure they're here till 10:30 every night. Sorting through what's going on, but if there are any lessons out of Tehran, one might be to approach these things very carefully, because what we discovered in Tehran was that although the nationalists, the liberals, the Muslim intellectuals were up front, the real power was held by some very unfriendly and very determined groups with a much more extreme agenda. And these were folks who were, frankly, capable of anything. The liberals, the nationalists, they were like us. They could write brilliant analyses. They could make great speeches. They could figure out a political situation and write articles. But it was the others who could throw acid in people's faces, who could go out and beat up a reporter, could burn down an opposite party headquarters. And frankly, in a situation of revolution and instability, those are the people who unfortunately come out on top.
Interestingly, even now, the Mojahedin Khalq, who seem to be supported by so many people in the United States, are just as evil, and they were horrible. When I was there meeting with reporters and meeting with editors, they would come in and beat up people and destroy the offices. And now they're saying they're a legitimate opposition. I wouldn't trust them as much as I wouldn't trust the regime in Tehran.
Well, and following up on Cairo, Don, because of your experiences in the region, and then I want to get to this other question, what about the power structure in Cairo? What would you predict, given the what's happening in the streets now and the Mubarak response?
Well, as I still work for the State Department, so I need to be careful about not stepping on the toes of my colleagues who work on the Egypt desk. I would point out that that in Tunisia you had a slightly different situation, and that the leadership there was not as closely tied to the military as the Mubarak regime is closely tied to the Egyptian military, and leave it for others to speculate where that might go. One thing I would say, though, is that after I came back years later, I served in East Asian and Pacific Affairs at the time of the transition in the Philippines, and Paul Wolfowitz was the assistant secretary. We had a roundtable discussion, the theme of which was, are we making the same mistakes in the Philippines that we did in Tehran? And the moderator led off with the idea, he said, if the State Department is given three choices, A, B, and C, the State Department is always going to choose B. And he did this to annoy Wolfowitz, and you could sort of see, he's a very calm guy, you could sort of see him clenching his teeth a little, and his response was interesting. He said that it makes two assumptions. The first assumption is that that the middle course, B, is wrong, and it may very well be that the middle course in these situations is the right way to go. And the second thing is that it makes the assumption that the middle course is easy, and it may very well be the most difficult thing between A, B, and C. The point I made, which he agreed with, and he was around in the Defense Department in the Carter administration, was that in Tehran, the mistake we were making was not that we were trying to follow the middle course, it's that we were trying to follow A and C simultaneously. We were trying to support the regime of the Shah while still reaching out to the opposition at a time in the Philippines where people would have thought it had been ridiculous to sell any kind of riot control gear to the Marcos regime. At the time of the revolution and the demonstrations, we were having that exact debate as to whether or not we would sell additional riot control gear to the Shah. And I think part of the reaction that we got, part of the failure in Tehran, and part of the success in the Philippines was that in Tehran, we caused resentment and distrust on both sides by trying to follow A and C simultaneously, where in the Philippines, we were seen as real honest brokers by hewing that middle course, by supporting what was a legitimate government, but had lost its or was losing its legitimacy as a democratic opposition was forming.
As I recall, having covered it, it was really a tribute to Secretary Schultz and the vision and what Senator Lugar and others persuaded the White House to do at that time. Gentlemen, sorry.
The five gentlemen at the table are all heroes of mine. It turns out that three, the oldest three, are old and dear friends of mine. It is also a fact that I've had the benefit and the pleasure of playing poker with two of them on more than one occasion. And I would like to take this opportunity to thank John Lembert and Alan Golosinski for their contributions to the well-being of myself and my family over the years. Thank you.
Forgive me for not applauding, Tom.
But I do have two serious questions, one tactical and one strategic. The tactical question is this, and maybe you've already answered it, John. Why some of the hostages were treated fairly well, and others were tortured, beaten, and the objects of mock executions. Why did it go down that way? Was it just the instability of the revolution, or was it planned, or was it luck of the draw, or what? And the strategic question is this. Will the current unrest in Tunisia and Egypt and Yemen spread further east and revitalize the Green Revolution? I'd like to hear your takes on that one. Thank you.
Thank you. John?
Okay. Well, Tom, I'd like to say it's been a pleasure helping your family, but... The first thing you learn, I think, as a prisoner is that the situation you are in is the ultimate in unreason and illogic. You will find no reason, no logic in what happens to you. And the fact that one person is treated one way, another person is treated another way, you will never find out. You will never find out why. Solzhenitsyn, if you read his stories about the gulag, it's very much there. I learned that from experience and also from my cellmate who had been in the army for 30 years and knew a little bit about unreason. Again, you don't know, and after a while you don't ask because these things happen. I mean, they identified some of us as bad characters. They identified others as not under what criteria. I don't know. The other question about the Green Revolution. I'll just say the events in Tunis had a huge echo on the Iranian sites. And one of the things they came up with, which is really cute, was a saying in Persian. They said, Tunis, Tunis, Iran na Tunis. Means Tunis could, Iran couldn't. Or it also means Tunis is Tunis, Iran is not Tunis, in the same way. I mean, they're arguing about it just as much. Why does it work in one place and not in another? My five second answer is that Ben Ali had a place to go. The folks in Tehran do not. I mean, can you imagine them running away to Saudi Arabia? I doubt it.
May I, Tom? Since let me speak to the treatment issue, because it's always been of some controversy, and I suspect, Tom, that's why you asked the question. Everybody that was there suffered in their own way. Make no mistake, it was not a picnic for anyone. And what John points out is very accurate. Very early on, they identified all of us either accurately or what they would like each of us to be, if it was convenient for them, and proceeded from there. And some of the things that they suggested that we as individuals, and I want to be very careful here to speak for myself. Each of us needs to speak for himself. But one thing that was common when they identified something that they thought would be particularly useful to their cause, and this is, they actually said this, and you've heard this elsewhere in movies or whatever, but we have discovered this about you. One of the things they discovered about me were some counterfeit bills that we had recovered and we were helping the Secret Service with, and they decided that I single-handedly was going to undermine the Iranian economy. So, for...
They're doing a very good job of that themselves.
They're doing a good job of that themselves. Right. And my reward for that was that I was going to get a fair trial, taken upstairs, and shot.
That's right.
All in that one sentence. Make no mistake, some people suffered just horrible deprivation. We all suffered deprivation. Some people suffered worse. But everybody suffered in their own way. There was bad treatment, flat out. People were beaten. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about that. So this was not a matter of time and solitude alone, which was painful in and of itself. But I would like to be clear about that, and I suspect that was something that you wanted clarified.
Let me also add that.
And then we're going to have to conclude, Barry.
Just one thing. Let me just add that being in prison for 444 days, whether you are, quote, treated well or treated badly, is horrendous. And no matter how you look at it, we were imprisoned and treated badly, even if we were not tortured. Some were not tortured, some were tortured. It's just being there for 444 days in darkness and isolation, that's enough for anyone.
Well, I want to thank all of our participants, colleagues, heroes, witnesses and survivors of one of the most extraordinary events in American history, as well as diplomatic history. And also serve again as a reminder that we have men and women and their families serving around the world in Iraq, in Afghanistan, in Cairo, in Tunis, in Yemen and other parts around the world, and they are on the front line every day, and we just need to do all that we can to understand and support and engage and make sure that we are all aware and that the American public is aware of everything that they are doing. So I want to thank you for this opportunity to relive and perhaps put in context.
Andrea, I think in that context, Susan Johnson, where is she?
Right
she's
up here.
Right here.
Oh, she's right there. She's trying to get rid of us.
No, just
she's got a commitment. But Susan Johnson and who else is here from state?
Oh, all of
and well, Ian Houston and the AFSA.
That guy, Ian Houston, right there, the executive director of AFSA, has been heroic, both here and up in Wiesbaden. What she has made possible, what he has made possible, and all of us salute you, Ian. But also the Assistant Secretary of State, the director. Is she here, Nancy?
She had to leave because she had an 11 o'clock speaking engagement. But
and I cannot let the event pass without saluting our neighbors to the north, Canada. We are a fortunate country in having a neighbor like that. Each and every one of you probably can give me and give us stories about how Canada has helped. But five of our colleagues in Tehran, six of them, escaped out the back gate of the embassy the day the embassy was being overrun. And there they were in the middle of Tehran, loose and fancy free, not quite sure where they were going, looking for refuge wherever they could find it, eventually finding refuge in the residences of the ambassador to Canada at that time, ambassador of Canada at that time, and his deputy, who said as soon as they heard from our wandering six, where the hell have you been? Why didn't you come sooner? You are very welcome here. This book is an example, is a story of the Canadian caper.
Let me just read. It's Our Man in Tehran, Ken Taylor, the CIA and the Iran Hostage Crisis by Robert Wright.
There's a Canadian embassy representative here today. If he would stand and salute us, please. There he is. Those Canadians at that time gave refuge to our six, and eventually they worked out secretly with their intelligence agencies and ours, this marvelous plan that saw us them slip out of town safely, but requiring them to close their embassy, sacrifice all of their interests across the board in Iran at that time because they cared that much about six Americans. And I salute you again for that.
Well, thank you all for coming. The American Foreign Service Association would like to also thank NEA and the Director General, Ambassador Powell, who had to just leave a few moments ago, for their cooperation and assistance in organizing this event. And most of all, I'd like to thank you, Andrea, our panelists, and the other hostages and people directly involved who are here in the audience for participating and sharing your stories today. And finally, I'd just like to express the personal hope that these yellow ribbons that you all have on and that we have on that are associated with this will come to signify and mean support for diplomacy and support for our diplomats. So thank you all very much. Thank you, Andrea.